I want to welcome everybody. It's Sunday morning, and it is April the 5th, and we have a few blessed songs that the worship team is going to give to you, and hopefully you'll enter into the presence of the Lord. And these songs go very well with the message that I have today. I believe it's a prophetic word, and it's called The Finger and the Voice of God. So before we go there, let's enter in and understand that the God that we serve loves us and he wants to fellowship with us so he can fellowship with you right where you are. Just open up your heart with your children. Have them sit down if you have any children. By the way, we're going to have a little skit for the children as well, a little puppet show. So hold your children steady and they'll be blessed as well. So let us pray before we come into the presence of the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your son Jesus to give us eternal life, to deliver us from this cursed world that is dying. You've given us eternal life where we never die. Holy Spirit, I ask now that you free us up from any cares or worries or our minds wandering or our eyes looking around, that we would just relax right now and center our hearts upon these songs. In Jesus' name we say, everyone says, amen. Amen. God bless you.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, song in itself is not what you have required. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart. I worship you.
Take me past your outer courts, through the holy place, Lord, past your brazen altar, Lord, I want to see your face. Take me past the crowds of people, the priests that sing your praise. We hunger and thirst for your righteousness.
Take me into the holy.
welcome, everybody. We just had the worship team bring us into the presence of the Lord, and sweet time to let our hearts hear what the Lord has to say to us. Just quick reminder, next week, next Sunday, we're going to have Resurrection Communion. We're going to thank the Lord on Easter Sunday together, and the men of the household will prepare the elements by having the bread and the juice so that we could all partake together next week, probably at the same time, 11 o'clock. I also want to say thank you for even holding on to the Lord, as we all are, because we're all going through a hard time. And yet God is blessing us. God is meeting our needs. And I want to encourage you to continue. If you're working, that is. I know some people got laid off, so it's not up to you to continue to give when you don't have it. But God loves a cheerful giver. So if you're still in the work business and you still tithe, thank you. You can do it right online or send a check to the church. Today's title is called The Finger and the Voice of God. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you give us to hear your voice. And what are you pointing to? May we have ears to hear what your Spirit is telling us and this world. In Jesus' name, amen. So turn with me to Daniel chapter 5, and we're going to read verses 2 to 6. But before we do that, I want to encourage everyone, as I'm being humbled. I believe we're all being humbled. I believe the world is being humbled too. Things that we used to hold on to and distract us or preoccupy our time naturally without having a spiritual connection has been removed. And I believe that's causing all of us to reevaluate our lives and say, Lord, what's important? Is eternity important? Is dying important? And that seems to be the focus today. I don't want to die, people are saying. I don't want to catch this corona device, virus in my life. People are fearful. However, I want to encourage everybody here that so far, the models haven't come true about all of these hundreds of thousands of people dying. Let's just pray, as we do with a snowstorm sometimes, when we say, or we hear the weather report, it's going to be a big snowstorm, and then the next day we find out it was only 2 inches because a wind came and blew it out to sea. Let's believe God and keep praying that God will blow this out to sea, and it's not going to be as bad in New York as they say it is. So let me pray with you as we read 1 Peter. I'm going to read 1 Peter 5. Heavenly Father, again, I want to thank you just for your word. It's an anchor to our soul. It's a light and a lamp unto our path. And we ask now that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, will speak to our hearts as everything has come down to a standstill, and that we are no longer preoccupied with so many things. May we draw near to you in Jesus' name as we are being humbled. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxieties on him. Why? Because he cares for us. Now listen to this part, verse 8. Be sober spirit, be on the alert. Your devil, your adversary, the devil, he prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour, but resist him firm in your faith. What does that mean? It means that when you have anxiety and fear, you're open to the devil. He's the adversary. He's seeking people who are so fearful that they put down their spiritual guard. So the word of God says, resist him in your faith. Don't resist him with rationale. You could use it, but it's faith, knowing that God is with us and will protect us. Now to the sermon. God is pointing his finger of judgment. And here's the story. Belshazzar, which was the grandson or the son of Nebuchadnezzar, and they had all of the vessels, the holy vessels of God, locked up, and they took them out and used it for partying. And that's when judgment came upon Belshazzar. So it says now, when Belshazzar tasted the wine and gave orders to bring the gold and silver vessels, which Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, so the king and his nobles and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. And then they brought the gold vessels, which had been taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was in Jerusalem. And the king and his nobles, his wives, his concubines drank from them. So you see the disrespect. Their God was the God of gold. And they drank from God's holy vessels, abusing it, disrespecting his holiness. And it tells us here that they drank the wine and praised the gods of gold, silver, bronze, iron, wood, and stone. Suddenly, the fingers of a man's hand emerged and began writing opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw the back of the hand that did the writing. And then the king's face grew pale, rightfully so, and his thoughts were alarmed, and his hip joints went slack, and his knees began to buckle or knock or shaking together. So get this picture. He's seeing this hand, as you could picture in your mind, a hand on your wall right now, and it was writing something. He couldn't understand what it was, so he called for Daniel, the spiritual man. And I believe that's how it is with us. You know, what's happening in the natural, we need to look at it spiritually. What is God saying through this coronavirus? Why is it that everything has been shut down? All of our partying, all of our restaurants, all of our recreation, the economy, the whole world has been shut down because God is merciful and he's pointing to us saying, judgment is coming. I'm giving you an opportunity to repent, to come to me. You see, in his mercy, he takes away certain things in order for us not to rely on them, and it forces us to look up to heaven. It's kind of like an amputation. If there is a gangrene in someone's leg and it doesn't get amputated, it's going to go right into the heart and kill that person. And I believe God in his mercy has stopped everything, amputated, if you will, the things of man in order for us to look up to the things of God. What is God saying? He's pointing a finger here. So what happened? Here was the interpretation that Daniel, the prophet, gave. Why? You have exalted yourself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before you, and your nobles, your wives, your concubines, all of the high risers, all of the nobles, all of the power of men and women, and they have been drinking wine from them. You know, it's kind of like the Bible says, don't drink the wine of Babylon. That's the world's wine. Drink the wine of the new covenant of Jesus, who has forgiven us of our sins. And it says, you have praised the gods of silver, gold, bronze, iron, wood, stone. They don't see, they don't hear or understand. But the God whose hand are your life and breath and all of your ways, and you have not glorified God. America has forgotten God. The world has forgotten God. We've gone to a place that has never been. It's not precedent. We've gone to a place in our schools. We've gone to a place in our legislation where what was once called sin and holiness is now obliterated. It's gone. And children are growing up thinking wrong is right now. They have no concept. I believe this is the time that God is saying, this is it. You've gone too far. I'm giving you opportunity to change, to look to me and not to this world for help. And it goes on by saying in verse 26, and this is the interpretation. He says, God has numbered your kingdom and put an end to it. And you have been weighed on the scales and found deficient. We know that this world's kingdom is going to end. There's going to be a time when God says, this kingdom is ended. No more man's kingdom. I'm going to set up my kingdom. And we look forward to that day. Could this be the time? We always say, yeah, it's going to happen. But could this be the time? Think about it. This is unprecedented. You've never seen this type of isolation. This economy defaulting. You've never seen people so fearful of catching a disease. I believe now God is also speaking. No, he's not speaking. I believe he's shouting at the world and at the Christian. He said in Hebrews 12, verse 25 and 29, about him shaking the things of heaven, the material things, so that the eternal things will be staying. See to it that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if those did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape who turn away from him who warns from heaven. And his voice shook the earth then, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. And this yet once more denotes the removing of those things which can be shaken as of created things. What's shaken? The money of this world is being shaken. All of our recreation is being shaken. All of our downtime of going to see plays, games, gambling, casinos, all of that has been shaken as of created things so that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. And what is that? That is eternal things. That's your faith. That's the things of God. That cannot be shaken. So let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. He wants to be revered. Holiness is who he is. So now what do we do? Well, First Peter gives us encouragement that we're being tested. Church, you're being tested. You're being tested by staying locked up in your house. You're being tested by not knowing the future. But what's that going to do? It's going to bring our faith to the top. It's going to refine us. We're going to have to overcome that fear with faith. And so that's how your faith gets stronger and more refined. So Peter says in 1 Peter 1:3-9, "Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Soon we're going to be celebrating next week the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Continuing on, verse 4, "to obtain an inheritance." That's a place to be, church. "It's imperishable, it's undefiled, it doesn't have any sickness there, no sin, and it will not fade away, it's forever. And it's reserved in heaven for you who believe." Hallelujah. It's reserved. You don't have to worry about your IRA or anything like that. It's in heaven, and that inheritance is not going to be taken away. Continuing on, it says, "We are protected," hear this, "by the power of God through faith," not fear, "or rationale, for salvation ready to be revealed in the last time." This is the last time, church. I believe this is the last chapter. Verse 6, "And in that," or in this, "you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials." And yes, we have been stressed. But remember the beginning. Cast all your anxieties upon him because he cares for you, because the devil is roaming around like a roaring lion seeking you to devour. Fear gives him opportunity. Overcome it with faith. "Though you've been distressed by various trials, so that the proof," the testing, here it is, the testing. Everyone can say, "I'm a Christian," or "I believe in Jesus," but now the rubber meets the road. Now you get tested. You're being humbled, as I am. "Draw near to the Lord, and he'll draw near to you. He'll never forsake us." Continuing on, it says, "Even though it's tested by the fire, we may be found to result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." I want to remain standing when he comes. I don't want to be on the back burner. I want to be on the front line. "And though you have not seen him, you love him." Do you love him, church? You don't see him, but you love him. Isn't that beautiful? "And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible, full of glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Remember, I read in verse 5, "protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed." He's coming. I believe he's coming. I believe he's given us a window. He's given the world a window. He's refining the church to come away from the things of this world and to be separate unto him. He's doing a lot of shaking here. The church is being cleansed. You know, the Bible tells me this when it says in James chapter 4 that God jealously desires your spirit. And if you are a friend of this world, he says, we make ourselves an enemy of God. So where is the line drawn when you've crossed over? I mean, we're in the world. We need to operate in the world. We are of the world. We are in the world, but not of the world. But where is that line? I believe the Holy Spirit is teaching us, showing us, hey, you've gone a little too far over that line. You'd rather be more with your friends of this world than with the friends of God. You'd rather be with your friends on the job than with your friends at the church. You'd rather listen to the things of this world and the rock of this world or whatever music you listen to and the lyrics you listen to rather than listen to some of the lyrics of holiness and of Jesus and of salvation. So I believe we've crossed that line just a little bit. And the Lord is saying, come back to me. I'm yours, you're mine, and I'm jealous for you as a man would be jealous for his wife, so I'm jealous for you. So he continuously says that he gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Here's the key. Submit, therefore, to God. Resist the devil. He'll flee from you. Draw near to God. He'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, double-minded. The world and God, trying to live in both and purify your hearts. That's the message he's trying to say to us. And so I want to bring this parallel of the coronavirus. Interesting, you know, the word corona, what it means crown. And isn't it interesting that man has a crown on his head of pride And God is using the very things of his pride to humble him. He's taken away that crown. He's taken away the statistics of a person succeeding. He's humbled this world through this virus. And I believe there's a parallel between the natural that's going on and the spiritual. And so I said the last verse was to cleanse your hands. And isn't that what the world says right now for this virus? Keep washing your hands. Wash it as many times as you want. Cleanse your hands so the virus doesn't stick on you. And that's what Jesus said. He said, cleanse your hands, or James, wash yourself from the virus of sin. No longer be contaminated. Keep yourself pure. If you confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let's cleanse our hands. You know, the Bible clearly says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Do you know that the asymptomaticness of this virus, a person could have it, mostly young, they say, and not even know they have it, but yet they can contaminate others. And that's how it is with sin in people. Oh, I don't sin. I'm okay. I'm not a sinner. Well, yet they're contaminated. They are asymptomatic. Their voices, their lifestyle, though they think that they have no sin and they're not doing any wrong, it's a virus that's contaminating others. So we need to recognize that we're all sinners and we all need the grace of God, everyone in this world. How about the parallel of now people wearing masks, covering their mouth, covering their nose, so they don't spread the virus? James says the same thing. Listen to this. When God is dealing with the church, he says this: the tongue is a fire, the very world of iniquity. The tongue is set among the members as that which defiles the entire body and sets on fire the course of life, and is set on fire by hell. Verse 9, and with it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse men, which we have been made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes the blessing and the cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be this way. This is what God is saying. Cover your mouth, spiritually speaking. Don't allow the virus of sin of your words come out. In fact, lift up your spiritual mouth and speak words of life. The scripture tells me in Proverbs 18:21 that death and life is in the power of the tongue. I could speak blessings. But the Lord is saying here, don't do both. Don't walk the fence. Cleanse your hands. Don't try to be friends with the world and speak like the world. Speak the language of Christ. Speak the language of redemption. Speak the language of life into the minds and hearts of people. How about this for a parallel? Distancing. Separation. It's got to be 6 feet. And isn't that what the Word of God tells us? It tells us in 2 Corinthians 6, 17 and 18, therefore come out from the midst of them and be separate. Do not touch what is unclean. And here's my promise, he says, and I'll welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. That's his promise. We need to separate ourselves. We're in the world, but not of it. We need to have that distancing from each other, from that of sin and those who are living in sin. Separate yourself, God says, and I will be a father to you and welcome you. That's God's promise. Hallelujah. How about this other parallel of covering your face, which the CDC just recommended just the other day, to wear a veil or something like that? Well, what does it mean to cover your face in the spiritual light? Well, it tells us here concerning Isaiah in 6, verse 2 and 3. It says that the seraphim, the angels, stood above him, God, having 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And one called out to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. So we see even angels covered their face, recognizing the holiness of God. When Isaiah seen this, he said, woe is me, for I'm a man undone. I'm a man with unclean lips. And they took a coal from the altar and they put it upon his lips. And he said, you're clean now. God's holiness has been trampled in the church, not all churches. Many churches are still on fire with the holiness of God, but we're becoming a little bit more culturally relevant, where there's no more dying to self. There's no more seeking the Lord. There's no more repentance. There just seems to be, you know, well, God's my friend, but he's holy. He's holy. And we lose that blessing when we lose the holiness of God. Well, I know God is holy. Listen, when you get that understanding of just how big and how holy and how pure he is, it humbles you. So we see the covering of the face that people are now going to be wearing. Why? Because of a virus, they're saying, and we can't touch our face anymore. Well, how about covering the holiness, not only of our mouth, covering our mouth to speak holiness, but also covering our face when we're looking at God. And remember, as we come into his church or into your home, God is holy. And let him bring his holiness into your life. On the upside of it, listen to this about the new covenant. In 2 Corinthians 3:16 through 18, it says, "But whenever a person turns to the Lord, this veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all with unveiled faces," we can come into the presence of God. We don't have to fake it. We come in as we are. But we come in with sincerity. We come in with our warts. We come in with our blessings. But we come to the Lord with unveiled face. We want to be sincere. We worship him in spirit and in truth, not in facades. So it says, "We all with an unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord." We are being transformed from the inside out into the same image of holiness from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit. The last point I want to make is excuses. God has taken away all of our excuses. There was a story about the Lord inviting the world to come and eat at his banquet table. And it's found in Luke 14, 15 through 20. "But one of those who was reclining at the table with him heard this, and he said to Jesus, 'Blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God.' But Jesus said to him, 'A man was giving a big dinner, and he invited many. And at the dinner hour, he set out his slave to say to those who had been invited, "Come, everything is ready." But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, 'I have bought a piece of land, and I need to go out and look at it. Please consider me excused.' Another one said, 'I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to try them out. Please consider me excused.' And another one said, 'I have married a wife, and for that reason I cannot come.'" God has taken away our excuses. There's no more oxen. "Well, I'm busy. I can't talk to you, Lord. I'm busy. I can't speak to you now. I got work to do." He's also stopped marriages. You can't even have a marriage of gathering today. "Well, I'm busy, Lord. I just got a new wife, or I'm getting married. I don't have time for church. I don't have time to meet the Lord." That's how it works. But then the first one said, "Listen, I got a piece of land. I need to check it out." Well, real estate right now is not at a premium. Right now, you can't even do that. So what is your excuse? What is my excuse? God has given us a window to humble ourselves, to ask for grace, to ask for mercy. He's giving the world an opportunity to seek him while they can before judgment comes. And judgment will come. And I close with this last thought. They were asking Jesus, "Jesus, who sinned more? These Galileans who Pilate mixed their blood with their sacrifices, they were killed, or for that tower that fell on them, were they worse sinners than others?" And Jesus said, "No, they're not worse sinners." But he said this, "I tell you," and he speaks specifically to the people, "unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." And he began telling a parable. A man had a fig tree which he had planted in the vineyard. And he came looking for fruit on it, and he didn't find any. And he said to the vineyard keeper, "Behold, for 3 years I've been looking for fruit on this fig tree without finding any. Cut it down. Why does it even use up the ground?" But he answered the vineyard keeper, and he said to him, "Let it alone, sir, for this year too, until I dig around it and put fertilizer in it. And if it bears fruit next year, fine. But if not, cut it down." There's a warning here, church. God wants to see fruit in our lives. You're not saved by the fruit. You're saved by the vine, Jesus Christ. But as we abide in him, we bear fruit. But if America or this world has kicked God out, has taken them out of schools, taken them out of what's right and wrongs, taken them out of how we should marry people, taken them out of the separation of smoking weed and getting that legalized and having legalization of all types of sins, disrespecting the holiness of God, both in the world and in churches. So we need to be introspective right now, because you're alone with God right now, and he's given us this window to cleanse our hands, to cover our mouths and let them speak words of life, to have the veil of holiness on our eyes when we come to the Lord. He's asking you and me right now not to have excuses. You might say the last point was, is this an essential? Because you hear that now with the government. Only the essentials can be open. The non-essentials have to stay closed. I believe God is saying here that repentance is an essential. It's not a non-essential. We need to open up our hearts right now, because this has never happened before. And you say, well, just ride out the storm. You may not ride out the storm. You may meet the Lord tonight. Or maybe this will pass and we'll try to rebuild again everything and put God on the back burner again. Don't do that. He's given us a short period, and he's going to say, judgment is here. It's too late. Cut it down. So my prayer to everyone here listening is, ask the Lord, give me spiritual eyes to see more than the fear and more than the rationale. Is there a parallel here in the spiritual realm that God is trying to show us? And let me ask Christ into my life. Why don't you pray with me this prayer? With your head bowed, if you've never received Jesus Christ, this is not the time to waste. This is your time, and it might be your only time. It'll never be more clearer. You'll never have less distractions than right now. Pray this prayer. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I believe you died on the cross for my sins, and that you rose from the dead for the justification. You paid the penalty. Your death was the satisfaction for my sin. And I accept that satisfaction, and I ask you to take my heart and let me follow you from now on in, for this world is passing away. But the word of God and you, Jesus, will live forever. You have an inheritance for me waiting in heaven, but I must live by faith and trust you. And Father, I want to also pray for us Christians, for the churches, that we too will see the parallel of cleansing our hands from the world, that we too would remain separate, that we too would see you in holiness. Lord, help us now to speak words of life, take the masks off and speak words of life, and not have a double-edged tongue of cursing and blessing at the same time. And Father, I pray for grace as we are being humbled, all of us. Let us not lose hope. Even though we're being refined by the fire, we will come out like gold. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, people, and I'll see you during the Devos. The men are doing a fantastic job of having a Devo every day, and you'll hear from me as well as you'll hear from me Sunday for Easter Sunday, Resurrection morning, and we'll break bread together. Remember, men, prepare the elements. You're the head of the home. In Jesus' name we say, amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy.
eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you, Lord, that we can still walk through those doors, Lord. And we know that we walk by faith, Lord, knowing that you will protect us. And we ask you to protect and strengthen our body, Lord, wherever they may be at this moment, Father. Just instill your Holy Spirit within them to give them boldness, strength in this time of need. And if there is anyone, Lord, that is feeling under the weather, we pray for your divine healing. We look forward to fellowshipping once again as the body, and you know that that is one of the great joys of my heart, Lord, to just be with my brethren. And you do tell us to forsake not the assembly of the saints. So we look forward to that day where we can all come together again. But until then, Lord, we ask that you would just honor this sacrifice and these you know, live videos that we are putting out to strengthen the body and keep us unified, Lord. So we love you, Jesus. We thank you for everything you've done at the cross. We thank you for your Holy Spirit raising you again from the dead on that third day, Lord, and proving who you were to the entire world. So, Father, we love you. We thank you. And we look forward to seeing your beautiful and precious face. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hello, everybody. Hello. Hey, my name is Rita. And so with that, I have introduced myself, right? Fine. Okay. Now, as you all know, we're on lockdown, aren't we? Yeah, that's it. But I want to find out what my brother Freddy is up to. Freddy! Oh, Freddy!
Oh, hi. Hi, Bill. Rita?
Yeah, Freddy, what are you up to?
Oh, not a whole lot. I was just thinking.
What were you?
I was thinking about how did I miss. I miss being out there running with my friends, going to school. But you know what I miss the most?
No.
What is it? Well, I really, really miss Sunday school, you know? And well, what do you miss about it? Well, I miss, of course, my friends at church. And I miss the Bible stories. And I miss the songs we sing, and I know what, I also miss something, the Bible verses we memorize, you know, and one that I can think of right now that we memorized was one that is very, very nice because Jesus said, "Lo, I am with you always, always." It always means just that, day and night, yeah, night and day, yeah, all the time, always. And no one can promise you that, right?
Well, you got a point there.
He said, I am with you always. Well, where does it say in the Bible?
Right over here. Let me show you. It's Matthew 28:10. Jesus said, Lo, I am with you always. Every day. Isn't that good?
True is. It reminds me of that song we sang in Sunday school.
Oh, yeah. Every day. Every day. What are we singing?
Yes, let's sing it.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before.
Every day with Jesus
I love him more and more.
He's than the day,
sweeter than the day. We did it. Well, I'm so glad you reminded me, Frida, that Jesus is a friend that's always with us. And you know what? Because of that, we can spread the joy of Jesus to others. You have a point. Well, how do we do that? Well, by the things that we see, like, for example, God's going to help us through this. Yeah, that's true. He promised to always help us, too. Yeah, and maybe we can call people that are living alone by themselves and they're lonesome, and we can say, I know, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you, and so do I. Yeah, and maybe write nice little letters with drawings that says, I love you.
Yeah, and Jesus loves you too. There you go. That's a good idea, Freddy. Well, anyway, why don't we say goodbye to our friends who are watching us? This is Frida and Freddy, and maybe we'll meet again. In the meantime, spread the cheer of Jesus, because Jesus is here to comfort and cheer just when I need him most. Bye now!